An enormous statue of a woman wielding a hammer stands here, its lower half lost to shadow in the depths of the bloom.
Why not?
Interesting. Well, there's Lascar. Oh, Lascars. These guys are sailors, duh. The sign reads, "This way to Little Nylish," in a difficult to understand scrawl. This tentacle maw appears to be dead. Its flesh is being reabsorbed into the bloom. Okay, let's talk to these Lascar guys. The Nascar. Not in your tongue, good we speak. Arechi, she speak like you. Is for Arechi to speak. Simple soldiers we are. Very metal. Arechi. 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 I don't know. These three humanoids wear intricately carved armor that makes them look like undersea dwellers of legend. You cannot recall having seen the material form from which they are shaped, either. Though their suits are bulky, their wearers move with a strange and fluid grace. You might have mistaken them for monsters, but their leader is unhelmed and appears human. She has close-cropped hair, an angular face, and her jaw is clenched as if she was subconsciously chewing on a problem. At your approach, she gives you an irritated glance. You address the Jemadar Arechi. Speak what you need, or be gone.
Making a note.
Then she reconsiders her words. Ordinarily, hospitality is ours. Forgive this one. The maw to our anchorages has closed. She indicates the hideous tentacled mouth that lies dead in the center of the platform. Another way we must find. Have you heard of open maws that lead to our station? She lowers her voice. Beseech you, even. Trapped here with the supplies we purchased for our compatriots. She thinks, this world is getting to me, and the frustration of speaking in a foreign tongue. If you want me to help, you'll need to answer some questions. Her jaw unclenches by the smallest fraction. Naturally, this one will seek to provide informative truth. I like the way she talks. How did you come to be trapped here? The maw died, duh. Left the anchorage where our ancestors have served for centuries. Sought resupply, as we have so many times before. Upon return, the way was closed. Again she indicates the dead maw at her feet. Worried now that comrades may suffer without us. She thinks, or worse, what if our ship returns while we are absent? No, that's too terrible a thought. Closed is the path we have taken so many times before. Worried now that comrades may suffer without us. Tell me about your anchorage. All the refuge we have ever known. We await the ship that will end our mission and take us home. Captain Janner commands us. If you find the Maw and speak to her, perhaps you can tell she can tell you more. She thinks, in a way, I suppose the anchorage is our home. After all, we have never known another. Not home, but where we await the ship that will take us home. If you can find it, Captain Janner can tell you more. Where should I go look for Maws? This one hoped you would know. We are strangers here. Buying supplies is all we know, not hunting Maws. She looks down at the dead maw on the platform. Here was the maw that led to our anchorage. Here it had been for many years, yet on our return, dead. I'll see what I can do. Farewell. Quest. I met three armored humans in the vast interior. They traveled to the bloom through a maw, but that maw has died. And now they're trapped. They're looking for a way back to their anchorage. Find a maw that leads to the lost anchorage. According to Arechi, she and her companions come from a place they call the anchorage. I should look for a maw that leads there. Okay. Anything about codex for Arechi? Just in case I missed it. Or... what are they called again? Arechi? Or Lascar. She's not in characters. Lascar. Soldier sailors in service to some long-vanished interstellar empire, the Lascars appear to be human underneath their bulky, highly polished armor. Their exotic weapons suggest that it would be unwise to antagonize them. Most of the Lascars speak an unfamiliar language and carry themselves with a practiced military bearing. A maw opened in the Bloom, connecting the Ninth World to their anchorage. Okay. Okay, so we are here. Oh, this goes to Little Nylash.
Yes.
Doesn't it? Yeah, all the way down there. Absolutely. So almost done looking at this area. Ew. The walls of this dwelling are covered in papers with various threats and slurs written on them. Ditto. Ooh, Ioxu shanty. Bloom Cultist ink pot.
Without doubt.
Those are those Bloom Cultists we heard about. Hail. You there, we need your help. The Great Devourer writhes and moans. The Vargellan Tinkerer is to blame. The Vargellan must smash his instruments and end his heresy. Yeah, let's talk to Inkpot. This man is tall and gawkily thin. His wiry hair looks like an explosion of metal springs atop his head. He regards you with bright, feverish eyes that seem too large for their sockets and smiles. Even as he motions you closer, the man is scribbling words on a scrap of paper. He has fastened some sort of harness around his body. It holds a tiny writing tablet and inkwell so he can continue to write as he moves about. Dozens of scrawl-covered notes are stuck to his leathery robes. And he thinks, there is the one who will aid the Devourer. I've heard rumors of one fitting your description. One who helps those in need. Help us, sister, he intones in a wet and breathy voice. We are extremities of the Great Devourer, and we beseech your aid to right a great wrong. Extremities of the Great Devourer? We are those who venerate the Bloom as divine and seek to become a part of it, if it will have us. He pauses. We are the only ones who can see that a great wrong has been done here. What sort of wrong? A terrible torment, he whispers. There's that word. Visited upon the Bloom, our god. It is the word of Ioxu, the measurer and meddler, who dwells in that nodule of flesh. He raises his pen toward the house that sits on the other side of the platform, red and stinking and inflamed. Ioxu desires to understand the Bloom, to quantify its impulses. This causes pain to our god. His eyes bulge even wider, and it occurs to you that you haven't once seen him blink. The evidence is clear for all to see, in the raw and swollen flesh of Ioxu's house. We have warned Ioxu to stop his pokings and proddings and measurings, but he will not listen. What methods are left to us? He lets the question hang in the air, an unspoken threat. Perhaps you can help him to change his mind. I can try to work out some kind of compromise, at least. Indigo. At the word compromise, his mouth twitches. Try, if you like, but blasphemers are loath to compromise. They're steeped in sin.
Making a note.
Ooh, we got scriptures. His face brightens and he pulls out a handful of scribbled papers from a pocket and shoves them into your hands. Scriptures! Scriptures of the Great Devourer to inspire your thoughts and guide your words. Another tortured smile cuts across his face. From the pen of Inkpot. Who is me? This handful of crumpled papers is covered with messy scrawl. Pretty valuable. They purport to be part of the canon of the Bloom Cult, but they seem little more than the incoherent ramblings of their author, a cultist named Inkpot. Most of the pages are covered with grimy fingerprints and thick, dried blotches of yellow phlegm. Ugh. Man, I'd be puking constantly if I was in this place for real. What are all those papers on your robes? Scriptures of the Great Devourer. They are ever-changing in imitation of the bloom. You see? He tears one of the scribbled papers from his robe, crumples it up, and tosses it over the side of the platform. Those words are gone, forgotten, but new ones can be added as we like. Yeah, okay, anyone can do that. He takes a scrawled paper from the little writing desk that is strapped to his body, spits a wad of yellow phlegm onto its back, and sticks it to his robe. Now these words are part of the canon. What are those papers again? The holy canon of your faith? Only a part. Everything written by an extremity is part of the scriptures, until the writing is lost or destroyed. No one can know all the writings, just as no one can know every part of the ever-changing bloom. Can you tell me about your beliefs? I will not speak of beliefs, he frowns, but I will tell you what is true. First, the bloom is a god, the only true god, and all that takes place within its body is solid and real. That which exists outside the bloom is an illusion, a cruel trick, a falsehood. Okay. Second, he intones, that our goal is to become one with the bloom, to transform ourselves into living embodiments of its will, and one day to be called to its heart. Oh, the heart. You want to be called to the bloom's heart. What does that mean? His eyes glisten. When it wants us, the bloom will open a maw at our feet, or reveal a tunnel where one hadn't been before. The passage will close behind us, and we will never be seen again by human eyes, but will follow its turnings to the heart, and be one with the devourer at last, and pray to no one ever again. When we have pleased the bloom enough, it will swallow us. We'll follow its turnings to the heart and be one with the devourer at last. Huh. What do you think of the Memorvira? When her will was one with the blooms, we revered her. But no more, he frowns. She is no Memorvira, not anymore. Not to us. Another will be found in time. He thinks, her time is done. Soon the bloom will take her as well. You think the ninth world is an illusion? I know it is. The people of that world try to tell you that life is not pain. They weave illusions and call them laws to protect the weak and the poor and the ugly, the malformed. But look closer and you'll see that they lie. He spits a gob of yellow phlegm off the side of the platform. This guy's disgusting. Only here in the bloom is the horror of life revealed without pretense. Becoming one with the bloom is our only hope of salvation. How do you plan to become one with the bloom? We clothe ourselves in its flesh, feast on its bile and viscera. If we are lucky enough to hear its voice, we empty our minds and let it govern our actions and our thoughts. His long, misshapen fingers clench and unclench. The devourer will only call us to its heart when its will is one with ours. He thinks, one day I will hear the bloom's voice clearly, not these vague whispers. I must not doubt. We clothe ourselves with the bloom, feed from its flesh until we can hear its voice. Then we make our will one with the devourer. These guys are screwed up. Something else? His mouth twitches, as if he's irritated to change the subject. Is it safe to drink the water from that pool? I shouldn't trust his answer. Better than safe. Those fluids are the holy secretions of the great devourer. To drink them is to put your mind in communion with the bloom. He leans closer to you, and your eyes are drawn to the profusion of festering sores in his mouth. You can listen to its voice and know what it wants, for a time at least. Okay. Farewell. Praise the Great Devourer! Hold on 1 second, guys. Okay. Do I dare mess with this thing? We have to see. We have to know. This pool is filled with yellowish water. A wide area around the pool is wet, suggesting that people have been drinking the unpleasant fluid and possibly bathing in it too. Look into the pool. Beneath the surface of the pool is a large reservoir of fluid. You can't see anything of interest in its depths. Drink some of the fluid. So disgusting. Bloom juiced. Oh. We gain the bloom juice fennel until the next part. Next time the party sleeps. That's the same thing as the thing we found. I have something with us. A canister full of it or something. You take a sip of the yellowish water. It has a greasy texture and a slightly sour taste, but it quenches your thirst. You take another sip, and you start to hear whispers. They're faint at first, but they grow louder, resolving into the chittering voices of the bloom. They buzz in your ears, scratching at the inside of your skull. You stumble, struggling to keep your balance. Even as your senses dull, the bloom's voices seem clearer than before. You're immediately aware that the voices here sound angry. Hundreds of them hiss and shriek in murderous rage, directing their ire toward the inflamed, fleshy dwelling on this platform. Again, you raise the yellow fluid to your lips. It's clear that the effects of your last drink still haven't worn off, and imbibing more of the fluid is likely to make things even worse. You dump the fluid back into the well. Let's see what the hell's going on with us. Where's our fettles and stuff? Bloom juiced, active until next sleep. Eerie whispers fill your mind, hinting at countless secrets to uncover. But how does that affect us? How is that negative? Or rested. Active until next sleep. So it's active until next sleep, then we always have rested. Plus 5% critical success chance. You got me. So where's this thing we found? Is it this? Yeah, flask of bloom water. This is the same thing. Hinting at countless secrets to uncover. But as far as game mechanics, I have no idea. Does this affect concentration? Doesn't say. Do things change when we interact with people and things? Inkpot looks up from his scribbling, his crooked mouth shaping itself into the mockery of a smile. We await your intercession with Ioxu, but our god is in pain, so we will not wait forever. Alright, so I'm gonna talk to him. Did you guys drink it too?
What's on your mind?
Standing still for too long. Alright, let's go talk to this guy. We have the hilt of his sword as well. Hello there. There's Ioxu. There's a construct. It looks like the Stika construct, kind of. You have lots of things. Inside this device is a sizable lump of bloom flesh. It lies upon a comfortable-looking cushion and appears to be asleep. There's a little R2-D2 thing. The top of this machine is covered in glass lenses of varying shapes. It appears to be some kind of monitoring device. You can interact there. Text and symbols flash across the screen, all of it meaningless to you. This construct is equipped with innumerable monitoring devices. Lines swoop and whirl across this leathery sheet, depicting what appears to be a map. Hello there. I thought he was going to greet us there. Meaningless, yes. This bucket is filled with quivering chunks of bloom flesh and organelles. On the shelves you see a few discarded notes and old books. A rack of test tubes sits alone and forgotten, overgrown with bloom flesh. These tanks contain floating blobs of plant or algal matter. They could serve as a basic but unpleasant food source. Maybe we should talk to him before interact. Let's talk to the construct, I guess. Then we'll talk to him. Barbs and blades cover the surface of this hulking metal construct. Its scalloped skin looks like a suit of intricate armor, the joints able to bend in directions impossible for a human. Though the construct is immobile, something in its design sparks a friction of involuntary dread within you, as if it were a predator regarding you. It might. The design of this construct is remarkably reminiscent to that of Waits for Prey, the construct you saw in the Memovera's courtyard. True. Although it looks similar to Waits for Prey, you can hear nothing of its thoughts, as if it were an empty shell. Let's examine the construct with our machinery lore. Probably shouldn't have used all that, but eh. The construct doesn't seem to mind your prodding and poking. Indeed, it doesn't react at all. By the time you've finished, you are reasonably certain that while it maintains basic locomotive and processing functions, its mind has been utterly erased. It is truly an automaton, now, lacking any sort of free will. Some of its weapon systems have also been deactivated, though its killing blades are as deadly as ever. I can't ask Callisthenes to look at it anymore. Who are you? It continues to stare impassively ahead, ignoring your attempts to converse. If it weren't for the faint hum from within its chest, you would question whether it's even functioning. Why don't you speak to me? The construct remains utterly silent. It doesn't acknowledge you at all. Hello? Hello? What are you? Tell me about yourself. Hello? Alright. Oh, I want to look at this. We got these notes. Yeah, we can't do anything with them. I would sell them. Probably. Ioxu. He's a Vargellan, I guess. Yeah. This Vargellan looks much like others of its kind. Violet red skin, yellow eyes, a tall crest atop its head. This one appears to have chosen a male form for now. He wears thin lenses over his eyes, and some strange device encircles his head, with weighted attachments dangling at the ends of long straps. His calloused, pointed fingertips are stained, and his garments are unkempt and in disarray. He looks impatiently at you as you interrupt his work, his eyes snapping between you and the door. His crest inflates with irritation. The interruptions continue. What would you have of Ioxu? Why do you keep looking at the door? Apologies from me. The noise and constant interruption from those outside are inconducive to proper behavior. They have been escalating their discussions toward violence.
I'll remember that.
The experiments conducted within this chamber are perhaps unlikely to gain the favor of the Bloom. Indeed, the great beast has evinced some displeasure. Its pathetic worshippers, who gather here to mock, have begun seeking ways to stop me, an effort to appease their deity. He gives you a hopeful look. I would reward anyone who can drive them off. He thinks it only shows I am doing something worthy. True knowledge risks danger. He shrugs. But knowledge has always had its detractors. They will do what they must. As long as my work lives on, I care not. He turns his head from side to side, seeing you with both his eyes. What would you have of me? I'm gonna wait on this. What sort of work do you do here? Look, smell, taste, measure, understand. Though his voice is flat, you can see the pleasure in his face. Apprehension is the key to knowledge. The Bloom is a creature unlike any other, yet who has taken the time to study its nature? The first is Ioxu. The work done here will illuminate the Bloom for those who follow. For decades have I been here. Physical structure, biological needs, behavior, mental construction, known history of the beast, history of its inhabitants, all these things have I gathered. Where does it originate? I believe a twin star holds the answer, a place of howling winds and immense gravity. Fear tells me that this creature is not yet mature, that the years will see its size increase. And he thinks, to what purpose? Destruction? Consumption? Ascension? I fear I will never know. Reality bends around the Bloom. Its ways twist and turn, but even where stability is assumed, the Bloom's presence resists understanding. It resists mapping. This is the importance of my work, to make secrets known so that all may benefit. The Bloom is a question. It is answers that I seek. What is that device in the middle of the room? The Bloom detests those who seek to understand it on a rational level. For some time now, it has sought my destruction, to erase all accomplished here. The device generates a multi-spectrum field that repels the Bloom's advances. Ioxu's lip curls. But this means only that it waits for me without. Had any devices not been available to create food and drink, I should have perished here. The Bloom desires to devour me. Protection is necessary. Tell me about that construct in the corner. Is that where the noise is coming from? Many years ago it came to my door. It vowed service to me if its memories and personality could be erased. I did not ask why, just as I would hope to have my own reasons respected. He rubs his eyes. It now serves to protect those who... I keep seeing these lights. It now serves to protect me against those who would do me harm, most specifically the Murdens and the Cultists. Its memories, its personality, were the price of its service. I obliged and wiped its core. Now it protects my body and my knowledge. The automaton in the corner. Is there an easy way to deactivate it, or something like it? He regards you flatly with both eyes, turning his head this way and that. At last he speaks. With the Bloom's followers outside my door, the risk of transmission of this information to potentially dangerous parties is unacceptable. You will not have the answer. Yeah, I really need to, I don't need to know that. I already defeated the other thing. I'm guessing I'm asking that to, deactivate Waits for Prey. But I killed it, and I got its head. And I didn't take any, as far as I could tell, I didn't take any, tide for doing so, either way. You will not have this answer. What do you think would make the Bloom Cultists leave you alone? Defeating them with reasoned arguments will be difficult. The Vargellan appears to consider. I present no danger to them. Not like you. A threat of force might persuade them. But I believe they tell the truth about enjoying the Bloom's favor. To oppose them is to draw its ire. I found this device in a Bloom cyst. It seems to bear your mark. His eyes bulge, and his flat voice gains a tiny bit of modulation. The scalpel? Where did you find this? This was among the first devices I created to test the Bloom, a transdimensional blade that could cut its flesh cleanly and preserve its properties for study. Yet a thief removed it from my care, and Abacost had entered my dwelling and absconded. Right, so it stole that and then got stuck in that cyst.
Updated my journal.
A power source for the blade is lacking. Transdimensionality is required. No more such sources are to hand here, but perhaps the crushed katana in Little Nylesh might contain such a source. Should you find one, bring it to this place, and I may be able to improve on my earlier design. Do you have anything you'd be willing to sell me? He looks around at his cluttered desk. I do not anticipate a need for these devices any longer. Perhaps they can serve you. Okay, so he's selling concentrated play flesh, embrace the all, plus one training level in concentration. This is a beetle-like parasite about the size of your hand, with a glossy green carapace. Most of the time it is inert, the only sign of life being a faint vibration. When placed on the skin, it grips the bone with its armored claws and inserts whip-like tendrils into the nervous system, probing the host's brain. Do any of these things, like, not involve pain? The coupling permanently makes the user more mentally attuned to certain artifacts. After a short while, the creature disengages from the brain, releases a cloud of spores invisible to the naked eye, and dies. Interesting. Entropic engine? Nice. 10 energy damage, 8 physical damage, plus 1 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 4. On critical hits, confer disrupted. Entropic forces destabilize the target, causing negative effects to increase each round, active for 3 rounds. Once used as a propulsion device, this has been refitted to work as a launcher weapon. Whether either of these are its original purpose, you cannot guess. The barrel fires a solid ball of energy, dealing massive damage to the target. Pretty cool. Spirit Shroud. Plus 15 evasion. Plus 15% evasion, willpower, and deception tasks. And plus 5 on intimidation and persuasion tasks. Nice. Comprised of thin, stretched-out faces of living alien beings, this cloak has a ghastly appearance. The alien faces have psychic abilities, and they project subtle illusions and hallucinations into the minds of those you meet, making it easier to bend them to your will. These illusions also render the wearer more difficult to detect or target. So that's if you want to go the evasion route instead of getting resistance. Oh wait, I have the Cloak of Faces, right? No, I have Exuvia. Oh, this is a cloak. Oh, I have Spirit Shroud, okay. This isn't armor. I'm confused for a second. It's pretty sweet, but... yeah, I can't afford it. Heretic's Fork. Granted ability, Scan Thoughts. Oh, this is you get Scan Thoughts. I already have Scan Thoughts. -2 Intellect Pool. Well, I'm glad I'm not relying on this, because I missed all the thoughts from the character creation to now. A nondescript piece of coarse metal that reveals the thoughts of those around you. It embeds both forks into the flesh of a user and exudes an air of knowing melancholy. A significant amount of willpower is required to maintain a mental equilibrium under its effects. Amplified Encephalic Rush, Refining Fleet for the Moss, Hyperlundriated Force, Ecstasy Paralyzer? What? Light Range Weapon. 10 mental damage and plus 10 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 10. Of course, we got the light weapon bonus if we use it. I'm not getting it. Can't afford it. On hit, confer dazed. On critical hits, confer stunned. Character cannot move or take actions. Active one round. The foot-long barrel of this device glows, alternating between different colors when active and has an organic feel to it. When touched, you also notice it warms up quickly and a slight vibration can be felt. Hexagonal buttons sit behind a small screen at the top, allowing you to fire a blob of energy that affects the target's mind directly, filling them with overwhelming visions of pleasure. The grip and trigger seem to have been fitted on later, made from a dull gray metal, cold with a few thick wires running from the top of the grip into the barrel. Despite the striking dissimilarity between the individual parts, the whole assembly is masterfully engineered with a clear purpose in mind. Yep, I'd say. Python driver, a light range weapon, 9 physical damage, plus 2 damage per effort, max plus 8. Light weapons, but it is ranged, though. Plus 15% to critical hit chance on weapon attacks. Air jets along the length of this weapon guide the user's aim toward the user's most... I guess, you know, towards the enemy's most vulnerable points, not the user's vulnerable points. Neuropraxic detonation. A cipher. Deals 20 mental damage and confers days to all characters in ranged. Active 3 rounds. A chain of barbed links encircles this pulsating knot of brain tissue. When the chain is broken, the bound psyche inside screams in an overwhelming glee that tears at the nearby minds. Screams in a overwhelming glee. Fluid armature. Huh. Botted item. 4 resistance plus 4 armor. Negative effects are minus 15%. Evasion and willpower and minus 8 initiative. Ugh, I don't want that. At first, this finger-length capsule appears to be made of metal. On closer inspection is a pellet of quicksilver contained by an unseen field. Pressing this capsule into the flesh covers a user in a protective subdermal layer that somewhat slows reaction times. And finally, psychic focus, another bonded artifact. Plus 15% on lore mystical, plus 2 damage on esoteric attacks, and plus 2 damage per effort applied, max plus 16. Negative effects, minus 15% evasion and willpower. Minus 1 training and endurance skill. I don't like these negative effects. Add that and the price, you know, I could just deal without it. This coil of flexible azure wire unfolds along a user's body with a pleasurable moan, drawing on their body's intrinsic energy field to improve their esoteric abilities. Ioxu, what are you doing with these things, you pervert? Alright, let's check out this thing.